Divine Truth Events, Events and Presentations by Jesus and Mary. This presentation is part of the General Discussion Series, where Jesus answers questions from people in COCO. Recorded on the 15th of September 2007 in COCO, Florida, USA. This is Session 2, Part 2.
Okay.
So we're all fed and watered and relieved.
Oh.
What is your song again? Why I keep bringing up connection with God is because if you connect with your parent, you can find out things very much more rapidly than if you don't. Remember last night I mentioned that if you connect with your parent, you don't have to go through experiment after experiment after experiment after experiment to find truth. The reason why is this. When you connect with your parent, remember there's this connection that occurs, which was the Holy Spirit, and remember all that is like a power cord that enables current to flow through it, and the current that flows through it is divine love. Right? Now, for your soul to keep receiving divine love, it has to be in a condition of truth. And I'm suggesting to you that not your truth, not just your truth, it has to be in a connection with truth with regard to its relationship with the absolute truth, God's truth, truth that God has. So, if you try to fake your emotional condition, are you in a condition of truth?
No.
No. As soon as you try and fake your soul condition, your emotional condition, you will not be able to receive divine love. Does that make sense? Because you're no longer in a condition of truth inside of yourself. And this is where a lot of people feel a bit difficult about it, because they're saying, on one hand, I've got emotions in me that are opposite to love. And on the other hand, you're saying to me, I've got to stay with those and be honest about them. And that is correct, that's what I'm saying. You have to be honest about the feelings that you have within yourself first, before you do anything else. Yes.
It's really nice by presentation, but I always have a feeling inside me. But we have a spiritual body, we have a physical body, and let's say we have our analytical capability and physical body. And I always feel, it's a nice picture, but sometimes when it goes through spiritual body filter, through my mind filter, analytical computer filter, and what I'm getting, I'm being disconnected at this level. And sometimes maybe my soul can be connected to the God, but what it's putting to my physical body is almost close to zero.
Sometimes I'd agree with that. There's a lot of people who have received divine love in their soul but have no awareness that they've ever received it. Right? What I'm trying to do is help everyone that I meet understand that the soul is the real you. So, you know, the other things you mentioned, like, for instance, the mind. The mind is influenced by the soul. The mind does things. So the mind might think, the mind may cause you to act, and the mind may eventually generate words as well. Huh? But all of those, at some level, come from the soul. And in the first century, it was said, out of the heart's abundance, the mouth speaks. Right? The reason why that was said is because it's the heart's abundance, what's in the soul, that causes the mind to have its thoughts, and what causes the actions and the words and everything to come out of you. Now, a lot of times, our heart has two types of emotions. It has emotions. Every person's heart does have emotions that are based on error. Right? And every person also has emotions that are based on truth. You are a mixture of both of those emotions. Does that make sense? The key to progress towards God is to start feeling and releasing the error. And so the error is no longer inside of you emotionally. Once you get to that stage, then every thought, every action, every word you speak is all going to be based around truth and love. But before that time, there will be often the opposites going on. Sometimes you might have this going on, sometimes you might have that going on, and you'll realize, oh, that wasn't in harmony with love. Or the key is to not so much judge it, but to look at it, to see what's going on. But I agree, many times people have a lot of things going on in here, in the mind, that they're not aware are actually coming from the soul's desire to avoid.
Yeah, but I still feel a little bit like it's a different level, so let's call it level, so almost different walls. One is a soul dimension wall or whatever. Another one is, let's call it spiritual wall. We have, and again, soul built all these minds, it's spiritual, and what it is in biological mind, soul built it. But it's like some kind of mirror of the perfect mind with broken connections, and instead its own basically like a software-based decision-making point sometimes. It's basically physically embedded or by my physical experience in this world, in relationship with people, events or whatever, environment. It's kind of a little bit different for me to process information. And it will sell or send it to higher levels, and higher levels will say, oh, so, hey, get something, hey, yeah, well. But sometimes I feel that, yeah, so understood everything, but what got back to my, I did not get a feedback from, or I did not feel that I got in reasonable, not reasonable, but feedback that they can recognize, yeah. And maybe adjust my physical.
But this is partly the problem, though, is that most of us have become mind dominant. You know what I mean by that? But we've become so intellectual in the way we see everything that we don't trust any feelings. We don't trust any emotions. And the only way God communicates is through emotion. So, and this is particularly the problem for men, not more so than women. Women have more of a connection to their intuition, generally, than men do. Men have more of an intellectual sort of bent. Men are often very focused on what's happening outside of themselves, whereas women are often very focused on what's happening inside of themselves, right? Now, for that reason, many men that become very mind-dominant. We're always trying to understand it in the head before we allow it to hit our heart, right? What we're going to need to do is to change that so that we allow it to hit our heart and then our head responds, right? Now, that is a big change for most men to actually go through. Many of the men that have been here have already started going through that change, right? And you've already started recognizing how that change occurs. But if you are, if you try to stay mind dominant, you will always find yourself tuning out of your emotions. I've had to actually go through the process of realizing that I'm not very clever at all, right? And in fact, the soul is the most cleverest thing within. It's the feelings are actually the clever thing. And once I've done that, everything's changed quite a lot for me. But understand that everything actually does come from the soul. So even the desire to stay in your mind comes from a fear within your feelings. Does that make sense? The desire for you to look for an intellectual solution to a problem comes from a feeling of fear within your soul. A fear about something. A fear about going emotional. You think about all the things you were taught when you were young about your emotions. Very, very young age. You're crying. What does a parent say? They don't say, go on, sit you on their lap and give you a hug and just say, cry as much as you want. How many parents did that? Do you have a parent that did that? Hardly anybody has a parent that does that, right? What is it instead? What are you crying about? I'm sick of you crying about. What are you crying about? And there's like, I'll give you something to cry about if you don't shut up, right? And so these things are taught over and over again to you. So in the end, you're taught that this thing is the best thing and this thing is the worst thing. In other words, you're taught your mind is the best, your emotions and your passions, which are your soul, is the worst. How many women have felt that all of their life? Where they're totally told by everyone around them, all the relationships and everything, you're too emotional, this constant thing, right? That's because people who say you're too emotional don't want to feel their own emotions. In the end, you are going to be very emotional and blissful. Right? So you won't have all the sad emotions connected. You'll release all those and you'll find yourself in a blissful state. But you will still be very emotional. Right? You'll get like a child, like I said last night. You'll feel passion and desire, and you'll do it as you feel. That's how it will happen. But what happens is that we've learned to become mind dominant. You think about it, if the material body disappears, what disappears along with it? The brain, right? If the spirit body disappears, what's going to disappear along with it?
The mind.
The mind. Right? Remember, your soul is separate to your spirit body. Here's your spirit body, and here's your material body, right? So if this disappears when you pass, you've still got the spirit body and the soul. If this disappears when at some time in the future, you've still got your soul. Does that make sense? So those are always going to be with you. Your emotions, passions, desires, intentions, longings, memories are all going to be with you, right? But your mind, at some stage in the future, is actually going to disappear. And what you're learning right now is learning how to live in a state where you're in this state constantly. Does that make sense? The truth is, you won't feel like paying any bill. Well, you know what would happen? You imagine if every single person on the earth no longer wanted to pay a bill.
There wouldn't be any bills to pay.
There'd be every person on the earth not even wanting to generate a bill. Right? So there'd be no bills to pay. Would there be any such thing as making profit out of food? No, you'd want to make food because you want to eat. And you want other people to eat. You want to give them the gift of eating as well. You'd share with them. And they'd share with you. You think about it. In the end, it's going to knock away all of these barriers that we've created, right? And it needs people to start. Right? So, yes, there will be a time in the future where you will not feel like paying a bill. Do you feel like paying a bill now?
I'm grateful for what it the electricity
and the telephone
and
a house,
yes.
Certainly. I love those things. Do you? Yeah.
I do.
Oh, okay.
Living in a cave, I'm not sure I'd
want to
do that. I like air
conditioning.
Ah. Florida. There's
a lot of... You see, is air conditioning in harmony with God's love?
Harmony, not. But since he's put me here in the
meeting,
I like creature comforts.
See where we go?
Yeah.
See where we go? We're basically saying... You see, the error is in the soul, right? We're willing to live in disharmony with love for our own pleasure. And honestly, in the future, if you want to be connected with God, at some stage, you're going to find that is also an issue. Like, I'm finding it an issue now, even just flying. Right? So I'm finding it. Every time I fly, my body reacts really badly. I have a lot of internal emotions because of it, because I know that it's not in harmony with love. Does that make sense? So when I leave here, I'm going back home, and I'm going to not fly anymore. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to visit you anymore.
No.
What I've become aware of is the soul can actually cause the body to actually teleport from one place to the other. Right? And so that's probably the... And what I want to do is get myself into the state where I can do that, so I can still go around and teach people the truth.
And then you can come off.
And I can come whenever I want, right? That's what it feels to me. Yeah, in an instant, right? And all of you can do this. It's just we don't believe it, right?
Yet.
But it's like everything. You don't know what you don't know, right? And it's only when you get to a certain level of development that you come to know it. That's how it is.
Personal question?
You can ask as many personal questions as you want. Whether I answer or not.
Okay. Do you live in a house?
I do live in a house. Currently.
With electricity or something?
What I've done is I got to a stage where I had 9 houses. And I'm selling them all now.
Like rental houses?
They were investment homes, yeah. And I'm selling them all, and I bought this property in Queensland that has no house for me to live in.
And it's the issue.
Yeah, like that. So my intention is not to live in a house anymore.
How do you shelter yourself from the weather?
Well, and I want to work through those issues emotionally, like as to what I do.
That's true, isn't it?
Well, only if you... It's all to do with perception, right? I want to be totally in harmony with my Father in the end. And I believe whatever He creates for me to live in is going to be good enough. And I feel that I'll be able to actually manifest. In the spirit world, you get to a point where you can manifest buildings and creations without harming the environment. And so my goal is to manifest, you know, on this land that I've purchased, to manifest creations of my own that are totally in harmony with God.
Is there winter in that area?
Yep. There's winter and summer at 45 degrees Celsius, which is about 110, 115 Fahrenheit.
You'll be sharing these techniques as you go along.
Well, that's the goal. The goal is actually for me, firstly, to go through it myself.
Okay, so you'll be the guinea pig.
I don't mind being the guinea pig. Well, it's like with all of these things that I'm telling you about, I've actually lived through them all myself first. Does that make sense? So that's why I feel like I can speak with confidence about all of these issues, because once they're a part of you emotionally, you can feel the truth inside of yourself, and you feel that constant connection with God. And so you know that it's the truth, and you don't have any doubt. So there's no such thing as doubt at all. So I have no doubt whatsoever at this stage that I'll be able to teleport. I have no doubt that I'll be able to fly either.
I have one more. What is teleport?
It's when your soul desires to go from one location to another location on Earth, and the instant you desire it, you're in the other location.
Beam me up, Scotty.
Beam me up, Scotty.
But does the body go?
No, your body will go.
Yes. Body goes.
Yes.
Well, there's plenty of spirits who work through people to do that already, yeah. There's about 80 or so occurrences that have been recorded.
You talked about the emotions and the metal. How comes that vice versa? Because the emotions can trigger the metal, and the metal can trigger the emotions. And our bodies are wired with currents of electrical impulses, which can't be destroyed because it's energy. So how come, you know, it can't be inverted? You say that the emotions...
You still exist when your body dies.
No, not at all. But the energy still exists.
See, I agree. I don't agree with that. You still exist when your body
dies. No, because I am just a conduit for my soul.
Well, what I'm saying is the real you is their soul. And the reason why
I don't exist as a person.
Yes, you do.
My soul does so.
No, I'm saying you do.
I do.
Why? You do. And I've talked to spirits who have passed over and over again. And I know they, from their perspective, they exist exactly as they existed on Earth. But they're even happier. They even feel better about everything.
It's a higher plane?
So it's a higher dimension of existence. But it's still, you are still you. Right?
Which I'll always be me then.
You will always be. And you will grow and you will change, but you will always be you. You will always be in you.
But why is the emotion the conduit? That's what's confusing to me, because the mind can trigger the emotion, and the emotion can trigger the mind. It's like
anything that happens in your mind is the result of a predisposition in the soul, something occurring in the soul. Now, I know people don't agree with me a lot of times when I say that, but I know in the future, if you continue progressing on the divine path, you will come to see that everything is actually from the soul.
Is Percy speaking? My mind and my emotions are in conflict with each other. I feel one thing emotionally, and my mind tries to be analytical and try to go through a step process. It's completely different from
But my that emotion. Desire comes from an emotion, from an emotion in the soul to detune from your emotions. You have a desire in your soul to stay away from some of your painful emotions. And in order to do that, you have to be in your mind.
And why is a woman more intuitive emotionally than a man? Is it because of birth?
No, it's often because a woman, by nature, has a desire to tune into her emotions still.
But I mean by the virtue of giving birth, the nurturing effect, is that?
There is actually a quality in the soul, in the feminine side of the soul. And by the way, when I refer to feminine also, it's to do with gay couples too. There's a quality in the soul on the feminine side that is more to do with trusting intuition. Men don't trust intuition generally.
But men have a feminine side too.
Of course.
You know, so
and men, this is what I'm saying, men can develop it, right? But a lot of men don't. A lot of men are so focused on here that they don't want to focus on here.
Then how do you deal with that? How do you deal with this?
Everything is just a choice. Everything is just a free will choice.
Sure. Okay.
You need to make a choice to deal with all of your emotions, even the painful ones. What happens with men mostly is that there are more men in a state of anger generally than there are women. Right? And the reason why is more men don't want to face sadness than women. There are more women generally in a state of fear than men, because women find a lot of difficulty facing fear. And it's just because of the different natures of the soul. Men are more willing to take risks, generally, and so they're more willing to face their fears. But men are not willing, particularly culturally, to cry, for example, because there's a lot of stigma associated with being masculine and crying. A woman is allowed to cry, generally, right? You're saying, oh, she's a girl, she cries, right? Whereas when it becomes fear, a lot of women not used to taking risks. They want everything safe and secure. So fear becomes a predominant emotion for many women. All of these things are generally to do with environmental issues. But the soul, both men and women, halves of the soul, both have the capacity to be 100% in the emotional state. Does that make sense? And the key is to understand that every single thought you have ever had comes from either a desire or an emotion within you, or a desire to not feel an emotion within you. One of those two things. In other words, every single thought or action or words you've spoken have come from the desire to avoid your own pain or to feel your own pleasure. Every single thing that you process.
Something you mentioned about future, the desire to see an efficient space in life. Humanity will be able to see that beautiful future, and it will follow the same thing.
And the next 5 years are going to result in very major changes occurring on the earth. And so in your own time on earth, you will observe many major changes occurring. Only though, when you start appreciating the power of your own soul, right? It's all going to be based around the power of the soul. The soul has the ability to manifest things without work, without physical labor. The soul has the ability to create. The key is tuning into that ability. The soul has the ability to move yourself and belongings to another location without using transportation like planes or cars or any of those things, right? The soul has these abilities. It's just a matter of tuning into these abilities. The way to tune into them is to develop the soul in love, right? Said in the first century, those who keep seeking first the kingdom will have all these other things added to them. What I meant by that was, if you seek first God's love, everything else will be given to you. Follow me? Everything else will be given to you if you seek first God's love. Now, the problem on earth is that the majority of times we don't believe that, right? Not a majority of times we think it's different to that, but it's not. The truth is that we seek that first, we seek God first, everything else. Now, if you talk to spirits who have done that, you can see the results. When you talk to them, you can feel what's happening to them. You'll have a time in your future, whether it's here on earth or in the spirit world, depends on how long you take to do it yourself. But you'll have a time in your future where you'll be able to maintain hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of conversations all at the same time. Just like a computer does. You know how there's some computers that have 5,000 users? Well, you'll be like a computer, if you like, but it'll be emotions that you'll be able to interact with thousands and thousands and thousands of people at the same time. You will be able to do that. Right? You'll be able to manifest and create things. You'll be able to create things, but only if they are in harmony with love.
Now, there's no time schedule that everybody has to follow, right? Whatever you think.
Whatever you desire. It's all to do with your desire. Yeah, always. Never anyone else's. Yeah.
If the time is right, then you will have changes take place.
Can I rephrase that? When these earth changes take place, go on.
Will I remember the gifts that I had and the abilities to use them at that time, and then what I believe in my time, what our purpose is, like hopefully, I hope I remember the truth, and that I can be a peaceful loving being, and then off of that, and all the chaos that's going on with us.
Inside yourself at the moment, Jane, you've got some fears associated with these earth changes. The key for you is to release those fears. Your soul remembers everything you want to remember. Okay? So the key is when you release emotions of whatever, sadness or whatever within you, what happens is no matter what the external events are, you will act in love. Does that make sense? Like, if you no longer have a reason to be angry with anybody, no matter what happens, you're not going to be angry. If you no longer have a reason inside of yourself to be sad, then no matter what happens, you won't be sad. If you don't any longer believe there is such a thing as death, then you won't be afraid of death. Does that make sense? All of these things are true. Like, all of these things are true. Your soul is the real you, right? So all of what I'm saying to you about all of these things are true. You will remember everything if you choose to. You can choose to forget everything too if that's what you want to choose. It's your soul's choice. It's your choice. You are your soul, and it's your choice. It's your emotions. So you can choose to do anything you wish. And the key is, the more development your soul has in love, particularly in divine love, the more you can choose to do. The more you have available to you to do.
Does that make sense?
And has there been any questions from our spirit friends at all? Alright, so let's look at your emotions and the ones that are going to be easiest to deal with and the ones that are going to be the hardest. How does that sound? The ones that are going to be the very easiest is emotions that other people feel about other people, you're going to find the easiest. Do you know what I mean by that?
Yes.
In other words, every single time you, I don't know what happens when you get together with your friends, but you know, you start talking about, such and such, she got involved in that relationship, and look what she did. She's crying all the time now, and you know, sometimes we even laugh about it, but you know, we're discussing other people's emotions about other people. And they're the easiest things for you to process. Right? That's why most people do it. Right?
So how do you know when you dealt with that? I mean, for me, I'm not attracted any longer to
those kind of discussions.
Yeah, to those kind of discussions. And in fact, I found that an easy way to excuse myself from those contacts, I use it, when someone who's following me tell me more,
yeah.
I say, you know what, that's going to
A lot of times, though, it does help us work through. See, people in that state are being helped to work through some of their own emotional issues, because every emotion that I discuss about somebody else feeling about something else is actually something that resonates with me at some point. Does that make sense? So it can sort of help them. What I do with a person like that is I turn around and say, well, obviously you have a reason why you want to feel about that particular issue. What is it? You know, so I just really focus it back onto the person themselves. And that's what I want to talk about with them. That is about, if you think about it, that is about, actually I'll put this in red, because it's, that is about how others love others. Do you get what I mean by that? Whenever we're talking about emotions that others feel towards others, we're actually talking about how others are loving or not loving others. Does that make sense?
Yes.
That's what we're discussing. Then there's emotions. The next set of emotions that are harder than them, but easier than the ones underneath to deal with, are emotions others feel towards me. My mum hurt me when I was little, she did this, she did that, you know, and all those kind of things. It's much, much easier for me to talk about that than it is to talk about how I hurt my children. Does that make sense? Okay, so emotions, how others feel towards me, are usually the next set of emotions that I deal with internally. In other words, I'm willing to go towards the relationship with my parents. I'm willing to go towards the relationships with the other people around me, my ex-partners, what they've done and all those kind of things towards me. But I only look at what they've done towards me. I don't look at what I did to them. Does that make sense? I only look at what they did to me, generally, at that stage. And that's how others love me. So that'll be the next set of emotions that you find easier to deal with. Does that make sense? Third set of emotions. Emotions. I feel towards me. Now we start to get into the not so easy bracket. Right? All the different feelings and emotions that I have that I aim at me, my self-hatred, my unworthiness, you know, all of these different feelings that I have within me that I'm focusing on. Emotions I feel towards me, and that's how I love me. Does that make sense? So when you start processing that set of emotions, that's when things start getting pretty intense now, because it's all about how bad you feel inside of yourself. You know, the emptiness that you feel inside of yourself, the loneliness you feel inside of yourself, how you're not loving you in your interactions with your life. So what I find in that area, that's where you address things like, and like many people will pay for themselves to smoke. In other words, they'll pay for themselves to suicide, and sometimes they pay $100 a week, $150 a week even. In Australia, like a pack of cigarettes is nearly $20.
Wow.
So you know, they're a five pack a week person, they're paying $100 a week to kill themselves. Once they start dealing with this emotion, they go through, before they deal with that emotion, they often won't pay for any good food for themselves. So like they'll be there smoking and paying to kill themselves, but they won't pay to get to buy some good fruit and veg. Does that make sense? Because they don't love themselves. And when you start working through that emotion, you work through lots of different issues about how you treat yourself. And then the last set of emotions that are really difficult, and the most difficult, are emotions I direct towards others. And this is how I love others. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, we're happy to consider the things we do good towards others. Huh? But we're not very happy to consider all the things that we've done that have been damaging to others. And a lot of times, you know, we don't even think what we do is damaging to others. But it is. And you know, because if the connection with the divine stops, then you know you're out of harmony. So once you start receiving divine love, you start feeling it flow through your body, your physical form, as well as your soul, you can feel it flowing into. When you go out of harmony with it, it will just stop. Does that make sense? At that time, you know that you've probably done something in disharmony with one of these areas. But usually it's in the bottom two areas. Because if you look at it, the ones from one and two, I can't actually control, can I? I can't control how others love others, and I can't control even how others love me. Most of the time we think we can, but we can't, because that comes from them. Does that make sense? But we can control and change how I feel about myself, and I can control how I feel about others. So this is where the real work begins, really. This is where we start expressing love in our lives. Now, if I am so embroiled in my own emotional condition, I will not see where I'm projecting feelings towards others that are damaging to them. So while you need to be connected to yourself, you also need to understand the laws of love. One of the laws of love is, if I don't take responsibility for my emotions, then I am going to project onto someone else and damage them instead. That make sense?
You say it one more time, please.
If I don't take responsibility for my own emotions, I will project those emotions onto someone else and damage them instead.
Damage their what?
Damage their soul. And And anytime I damage their soul, I am also damaging my own. There is a law called the law of compensation, or the law of karma, you've heard of it as. What you sow, you reap. If you damage or project emotional damage onto others, your soul also receives that emotional damage too. Does that make sense? That's the law of the universe. So for example, if I murder because I'm angry, I am going to have to feel every single emotion of the person that I murdered, that they had about the murder. I'm going to have to feel it as the murderer at some point in the future as well. Does that make sense? This is what the law of compensation will exact from me. Every time you damage another person, the damage, and I'm saying damage from the point of view of the absolute truth, because a lot of people think they were damaged by you and they are. Right? A lot of people feel that when you tell them the truth, that hurt them, right? Well, that's not true. If the truth hurts, right, it's because of the error within the soul of the person receiving it. Truth is always loving, so telling the truth is not unloving. Right? But a lot of people will try to tell you it is, right? Particularly if they are on the receiving end of the truth. Right? Truth is always loving. So sometimes be aware that a lot of the comments I'm making are such that just because you think something is unloving, it doesn't mean that God thinks it's unloving. And just because you think something is loving, it doesn't mean that God thinks it's loving. Right? And what we're coming to do is know God. We're coming to know what God's laws are, not our own.
How does it work in this law of attraction? Because if I meet someone from another person, maybe this person attracts me in their life.
True. And so the person who got murdered by the murderer certainly attracted that.
Yeah.
But does that justify the murder?
No.
Does that make sense? Yeah, it's a bit like, and this is the same with everyone. Like the person who, we got a person on one side who was angry with this other person who was in a state of fear. The person in a state of fear attracted the angry person. But that doesn't mean the angry person is justified to be angry with the person who's in a state of fear. Does that make sense? And if they project their anger on the person who's in the state of fear, then straight away there's a penalty on their soul. And there's other person that's got some damage too, right? So the thing you've got to remember is that just because an attraction occurs doesn't mean that you have to do anything about it. You can act in love. So you could, instead of, like this person in fear, you could be in a state of anger and attracted to the person in fear. Or you could be in a state of love and go to the person in fear and say, look, did you know you've got this fear? Which one's better for them? Isn't it better that you're coming from a state of love? Right? But certainly, the person in the state of fear has attracted their anger, the anger around them, certainly. But that doesn't justify the angry person being angry with them. Right?
The emotions, one of the emotions, I think that it's like I'm unkind or whatever. And the beginning and I realize it, while I was sitting there thinking, I'm thinking it's occurring in my mind because I can own it, but did I really feel the emotion first and then put it in my mind? So I did feel feeling. I just wasn't aware that the feeling came before I realized that I injured you.
Okay. Yeah. What happens a lot of times is that we're not aware. The transactions of the soul are very instantaneous. They don't require time to actually experience. Does that make sense? Whereas the transactions in the mind, the reason why we finish up losing our mind completely is because all transactions in the mind require time to process. Does that make sense? Transactions of the soul don't require time to process, they're actually instant. And that's the beauty of the soul. The soul has instant power, whereas the mind only has power that is developable over time. Right? Now, if we have an emotional feeling, that always will generally generate thought or words or actions. This is what a lot of people call the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind is actually the soul. Right? And the reason why it's subconscious is because for most people, they have no awareness that it's their emotions, what emotions are driving them, right? So for instance, the lady who's getting abused in her relationships, when she was young, she was obviously harmed by a male in her life, right? In some way, either no love was given to her, or her dad might have been abusive in some way, might have been an alcoholic, may have been sexually abusive, violent, angry, and those emotions projected on that child, right? She grows up into a woman. What does she expect love to be? And in her mind, she thinks, love is going to be always kind to me, always considerate, someone to hold my hand and hug me at nights, and all those lovely things, right? But in her soul, what's she feeling? In her soul, what she's feeling is love is abusive, damaging, belittling, and so forth. So what's the beacon of the soul doing? Sending out these messages to the universe. I want someone to love me, but that person who loves me has to abuse me, treat me badly, right? While that emotion's within me. Now, she's not thinking that in her mind, obviously. In her mind, she's thinking quite the opposite. And this is why, so oftentimes, the mind can be in complete disharmony with the soul's condition. Now, often we don't want to face what we're feeling within. Does that make sense? We don't want to face that we actually want to be abused. Who wants to face that? Who wants to face that I want to not be loved? Who wants to face that, really? How does that feel, to be so unloved in life that you actually want no love? Because you're so afraid of it. You're so afraid of what it's given in the past. Can you see? Yes, you need to go into that emotion.
And I just got something that I would like to. Can you remember what I want to ask?
Yeah, I'm not going to be able to do that today. Where time-wise is pretty getting close to, close to when I want to go, and so I need to leave around 1 o'clock. So, so unfortunately, we're not going to be able to do that today. My suggestion, though, with regard to spirits, is bear in mind that every spirit is a person who has lived on earth.
Every spirit?
Yep. Now, when I say they've lived on earth, there are some spirits who have obviously miscarried, so they haven't spent much time on earth. So there are some spirits who have been aborted too, right? There's 50 million abortions a year. So 50 million spirits every year haven't had the opportunity to live on earth. We have a full life on earth. So, but every one of them has had the incarnation experience. Every spirit that you connect to in the spirit world will be in a different state emotionally. The ones that you will be attracted to will be the ones that you want to hear from, and often you're attracted because you want to hear what you want to hear. Does that make sense? Now, this is why I find it interesting in a lot of discussions I have, because I know that a lot of people don't want to hear what I'm saying. Yeah? And honestly, the spirits that are telling you things you don't want to hear, but are telling you them in love, are the better types of spirits to listen to than a spirit who is just feeding you crap.
Yes.
And there will be millions, and there's actually billions of spirits in the spirit world who are willing to feed you false information in order to get an emotion from you. Right? Now, just to give an example, there's a group of men that I've met in Australia, and they pray, when I say pray, not the pray, not this pray, they pray on women who visit spiritualist meetings. What they do is they have a feeling inside that they feel that God promotes free love. So the 60s, 50s, 60s form of love, right? And what they do is they go to spiritualist church meetings and all those kind of things to connect with women who have emotional injuries so they can have sex with them and also abuse them in other ways. Like one man I know, he has nothing to himself. He doesn't have a car, he doesn't have a home, he doesn't work ever. All he does is he goes from woman to woman in spiritualist churches who are willing to look after him, to mummy him. So what he is preying on is the mummy issue, right? A lot of women are willing to mummy their men, right? Because that's what they feel being a woman is all about. And these men are willing to abuse that relationship. Now, when these men pass into the spirit world, what do you think they're going to be doing? Exactly the same thing. Anybody say? Until they have a realization that what they're doing is in disharmony with love. Right? Now, there are many spirits who are willing to prey on you, who are willing to abuse the relationship they have with you. The reason why they're willing to is because they want something from you. Sometimes it's a feeling of power that they're looking for. Sometimes it's a feeling that, oh, she listens to me all the time, no matter what I say. You think about it, if you've never been listened to on earth and you pass in the spirit world, what are you going to want? You're going to want to be listened to, right? And if you can find someone on earth who believes you're Jesus or Muhammad or someone else that you can talk to and they'll listen to everything you say, wouldn't it be great? You don't even have to prove your credentials, do you? You don't even have to, you know, relate any memories about your life because they're going to believe what they want to believe. Yeah? So, be careful of that, right, with regard to spirit world. I'm not saying be afraid of it, because if you're afraid of it, it's just an emotion you need to work through. Does that make sense?
How do you be careful?
Interact with every single person from a condition of love. Interact with spirits with a condition of love. Ask yourself, am I trying to get something of power from this spirit? Am I trying to feel more special within myself through this connection? Right? What does the spirit want from me? Do they want to feel more special or connected?
How do you know it's a spirit?
Sorry?
How do you know it's a spirit?
Anybody who talks to you in your mind is generally a spirit. If it's a spirit talking to you.
But that was our subconscious.
No, your subconscious doesn't talk to you. It's feelings.
It's emotions.
Yeah.
Feeling.
Isn't that the devil that's working, preying on you when you talk about these negative feelings and emotions?
I'm going to say something very confronting.
That's evil.
There is many spirits in a very poor spiritual condition who are willing to pray on you. But there is no master leader of those spirits. A master enforcer of evil, if you like. There is no devil. My opinion is that if there is a devil, it is just the evil emotions within you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And you can get rid of it quite easily by experiencing them and releasing them. There are very many spirits who are very negative in their condition, who are very sad in their condition or angry in their condition. I've talked to many groups of spirits through mediums that have been very, very upset and angry with me, for example, and are willing to, you know, some have tried to kill me even as much as they could with regard to the spirit influence. So they were, and they're willing to try and get people on earth to try to do the same for them. So there are many spirits in the spirit world in bad condition, but they can only prey on the emotions that are left within you. Does that make sense? So if everything, every interaction you're having is from a condition of love, then how
can they have anything to pray on? They can't, can they? They can only influence you when you're not in a condition of love. Does that make sense? Yeah, in the end, the best protection is love, right? Every time you recognize when it's not loving, you feel it inside of you when you feel a transaction that's not loving. If someone projects anger at you, is that loving? No. But if a spirit nags you day and night, like some people say they hear voices all the time, I'm driving them nuts. Is that loving?
No.
So is that spirit loving? No. Now, he may claim to be whoever he wants to claim, but in the end, whoever he is isn't loving. Does that make sense? If a spirit doesn't let you sleep, is that loving? So, you can see these things quite easily if you look at it from the point of view of love. It's only when we go down the metaphysical road of trying to do the crystal thing and the smudge stick thing and everything else, right? And no, not decrying any of these things. If you want to do them, do them. They're not going to do much good because they're not coming from a point of view of love. They're coming from a point of view of fear. Anything that comes from a point of view of fear is not going to be very effective. Does that make sense? Remember, though, that love has to be a real feeling in you. If you don't feel love, then you're not going to be able to manufacture it.
Action from love, from a place of the divine love, you can take the same action and do it from that place and have it be an expression. In other words, if I'm doing smudging from a loving place, I can do smudging from love or from fear. Not one behavior is always a manifestation of a particular emotion.
Okay. Everything in there is real. Mm-hmm. Anything outside of there is just stuff. Right? Your intention is what changes everything.
Okay.
Nothing else. Nothing else. You'll get to a point where you'll be smudge stick music, and you say, you look at the stick and say, why the hell am I doing this? Right? Because the feeling in here is already done, right? Does that make sense?
Oh, yes.
And this will happen a lot. Like, you'll get to a point where you look at your glass crystal balls, yes, that you've got safely in the kitchen cabinet that you view as a precious commodity, right? And you'll look at it and you say, why have I got this?
Yes.
And then you'll give it to some kids to use as bowling balls, something like that, right? Because in the end, everything, you start realizing that everything comes from the power of the soul. Right. Is that what they say?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So you look at a lot of actions that are taken by spiritualist people today, and a lot of them are based around fear, really.
Yes.
And even when they are based around love, it's what they've been told is love. Do you know what I mean? A lot of times it's not from the heart. It's not from their emotions. When you understand the power of the soul, you will not feel, you'll feel like they are the only real thing. Every interaction I have with you is based around the soul feelings that I feel for you. It's not to do with what's going on in my mind or anything like that. It's to do with how I feel. That's what's real. If in my soul I feel anger towards you, then straight away it's not a love-based transaction. Yeah. Now, I can manufacture love all I want, but if it's not here, it doesn't exist. Well, I think that's enough for today, I feel. It's been really good meeting all of you, by the way, and I hope very much that you continue your emotional work, right? Because that is the work that is going to be really precious to you in the long term. If any of you have not got any CDs, there's some CDs up the back that can be taken, and some ask some questions about what were on the CDs. Basically, a brief description is this. There are two directories on the CD. One directory is about divine love. Divine love. And the other is about natural love. Now there's about 10,000 pages or so of written material, channeled material, most of it. Some of it is stuff that I've put together briefly in a hurry before my trip.
to do with divine love and the principles of divine love. Does that make sense? A lot of the material is also under natural love. There's things like, what are the hills like? Well, there's channeled material about people who've gone to the hills and who can tell you what the hills are like, for example. There's channeled material about people who were ministers on earth and when they passed, on the natural love path, what they experienced. So most of it is channeled material. There's a bit of stuff that I've written on there as well, just to give you some principles about divine love as well. So basically it's into those two areas. There are Word documents, there are PDFs. So with the Word documents, all of these are copyable, right? Obviously my feelings are, don't modify them if you're going to copy them and give them to someone else. You distort the integrity of them if you do that. But it's up to you what you do. In other words, it's your free will. You want to modify them and change the whole lot and send out 100,000 CDs, well, that's up to you. I'm not going to stop you.
And your intention with that material is to help us make our own choice, or?
Yeah, to help you make a choice. Do you want to follow the divine love path and actually, do you want to find out more about both paths? All the material is there. In the end, whether you grow in natural love or divine love, I just prefer that you grow. Does that make sense?
So you're okay with us sharing the information?
Yes, copy them as much as you wish.
Can we put it on our website?
You can put it on websites or whatever you want.
I have a question. I don't know if you know. Yesterday, I was in class. You said that the Abraham energies are now split. Some of them are on the divine love, some of them are on the natural love. Could you briefly explain that?
There are groups of people channeling to a lot of people on Earth. And what happened with the Abraham group was a year or so ago, and I connected with them through a medium who was channeling the Abraham group of spirits. They are not one person, as you know. But now, what happened was, they were originally on the natural love path. Right? And what happened was that through the discussions that I had with this particular medium, they were listening to the discussions as well. What happened was a group of them tried the experiments that were suggested to them by some celestial spirits on the divine love path. Right? Now, not all of the group decided to do that. Some of the group decided and some didn't. The ones that didn't choose to do that stayed on the natural love path. And the ones that have chosen to do that are on the divine love path.
I just started channeling them about a year ago.
Right.
So how would I know if I'm channeling from the natural love or from the divine love? Just ask them?
And yes, although there's a lot of people that believe they're the one and the same thing.
Oh, right. So there's a question.
All right. The key to it, there's a few questions that you can ask them as to what's going on. Firstly, some of the principles that we've taught, do they believe that there is, like, the divine love can enter the soul? Do they believe it? What sphere do they live in? Is a good question to ask. What dimension do they live in? And then get verification. Sometimes they don't know what dimension they live in. So I've talked to some natural love spirits who believe they are in the 13th sphere. But when I talk to the divine love spirits that I know are on the divine love path, the divine love spirits said they were in the second sphere. So the natural love spirit thought she was in the 13th sphere when she was in the second sphere.
I think a question was put to them before, and they said they could, maybe the question was phrased wrong, they said they could be anywhere.
They could be anywhere under the sphere that they're currently in. But they certainly can't go higher than the sphere they currently in. That applies to all spheres.
Now, when you talk to Abraham on the natural world, so it's really, it's a crapshoot then, because if they think they're in seven, but they're in second, then how do you know what you're hearing?
What are the principles of divine love? You become more childlike. You become more emotionally focused. You become God-reliant, totally God-reliant. Right? These are the principles of divine love.
Okay.
if the spirit you're talking to is adult-like and self-reliant and promoting your self-reliance and intellectually developing, then obviously they're not on my love path even if they think they are. Does that make sense? All you need to do is just determine those things through your interaction with them. Alright? The other thing is that you, when you personally choose to get on the divine love path, as a medium, you, and anybody that supplies it, you will be assigned a spirit on the divine love path as your guide. Does that make sense? When you make a heartfelt choice to go on the divine love path. Now, when that occurs, you may find the energy change between you and the group of spirits you're channeling. Because if the group of spirits are not interested in that path, which most spirits in the natural love path are not, then you'll feel like that connection is lessening or slowly disappearing. Does that make sense? And the Abraham group of spirits, some of them have a very, very strong resistance to the divine love path. The reason why is because they've had lots of, they've done lots of progression over many thousands of years through their own power, through their own self-reliance. Does that make sense? And because of that, they've become so self-reliant that they don't want to become God-reliant. They actually believe they're already God-reliant. They are not willing to be humble and actually listen to the experiments that the celestial spirits are telling them about. Yeah. Now, there's also a group of the Abraham initial group a year ago that also got on the divine love path, so they are very much more humble and different as well. But the key is look at how you get treated in the transaction. Right? And Natalie, who's not here at the moment, can tell you some things. So my suggestion is to email maybe back and forth between yourself and Natalie a bit and talk to her about what kind of interactions you're getting. Most of the spirits who channel on the earth at the moment are natural love spirits. Right? And the reason why is because most people on earth find it very, very difficult to connect with divine love spirits. To connect with a divine love spirit, you need to have a desire to deal with your emotions completely. And a lot of mediums do mediumship to run away from themselves. Does that make sense? So the key as a medium is make sure you do most of the work with your emotional self, not using mediumship to get away from your emotions, to feel better inside.
Which level are the archangels?
Well, some call themselves archangels. The ones who call themselves archangels are actually in the sixth sphere. The ones who don't call themselves archangels, but people on earth refer to them as archangels, they could be in the celestial spheres. When I say could be, the majority of those ones don't feel themselves to be archangels. They just feel themselves to be your sister or your brother. Does that make sense? But there are people on earth who use terminology saying they are archangels. But the ones from spirits who call themselves an archangel, they are always on the natural love path. Because in the end, all of us are best brothers and sisters. So, if I want to, the word arc, whatever, what does it mean? Particularly when it's written A-R-C-H, what does it mean?
Over.
It means over. Yeah. Angel over another. Do you think a celestial spirit would feel that way? Remember the spheres? We had
22.
We had 1, 2, 7. That's called the spirit world. And the celestial spheres are 8 to 21. The celestial spheres, and above there is the soul world, if you like, or the soul spheres.
Deep water group.
I'm not familiar with this.
seven souls that went all the way to the top and now they're reincarnated.
Mm-hmm.
They made it all the way to the top and now they're reincarnated and they have to start all over again?
It's not as bad as you may think. They have a lot of emotions to do with because they have all the referred emotions from their first life. All of their emotions are the loss of their spirit life. And when I say the losses, they had some beautiful experiences in the spirit world which they now feel quite disconnected from. And then they also had all the emotions to deal with this life, and then they also had all their soulmates' emotions that they chose to take as well.
And so, their parents?
And the parents' emotions that soaked into them at the reincarnation phase. But, so they've got a lot of emotions to deal with. About six times the amount of emotions the average person has to deal with.
When a woman conceives, at which stage is the soul sort of into?
Usually it's within the first 10 days. A lot of times a woman will feel the process. A lot of women who are particularly spiritually minded say that they feel when a soul attached itself to the form that's within them. And usually that occurs within the first 10 days.
Personal question.
Yeah?
Do you find your soulmate yet?
No. And I haven't been ready, to be honest. There's still emotions I've been working through about my soulmate. And don't forget, to find your soulmate requires two souls, two halves of the soul to be ready, not just one. So even if I was 100% ready, I know she is not ready to meet me at the moment either. So even when I'm 100% ready, I can feel her emotions at the moment. And I know that she is not ready to meet me.
Does that make sense?
But you can be blissfully happy without a soul. What I've presented to you over the last day is just an introduction. It's just an overview. Does that make sense? And because of the time allotted, we really can't go into more details. But the one thing I must say, everything is to do with, right? And I want to really emphasize that with you. Because you will be tempted, even in the future, to try going down the intellectual road when you become frustrated in particular. The key is to deal with everything emotionally, not intellectually. Because it's the emotional work that causes the change in the soul. Right? So my focus a lot of times when I'm talking with people is to just focus them back onto their emotions. So even if nobody wants to hear about God or hear about love or hear about any of those, you know, those religious things, as they term them, because to me it's not religious at all. Even if they don't want to hear any of that, right, focus them on their emotions. You focus on your emotions. What do you feel from them? What do they feel from you? When you do that, you're going to open up their soul. When their soul opens up emotionally, that's when they're going to be able to accept other truth. Does that make sense? So it doesn't matter about talking about all these other things that nobody wants to hear them. But talking about that is the real transaction. You will find people will be attracted into, when you have a desire to deal with your own emotions, people who want to deal with their emotions will be attracted to you. Does that make sense? It's really quite simple. When you have a desire to stay away from your own emotions, you will get busy, you will have work problems, you will have all these other things keeping you busy, keeping you away from your emotions. Does that make sense? When you desire to deal with your emotions, everyone around you will eventually be attracted with you to you because they want to deal with theirs too.
Would there be some website that
would
be in the materials? I'd like to get one.
Pretty much all the material I've done is on the CDs, so take a look. And there is a website that's got a forum on it, but I find most people, when they start their emotional work, it becomes very private. And so the forum is very rarely used for that reason. And I have put some things on the forum, but honestly, all the material is on the CDs. My suggestion is those of you who are very interested in dealing with your emotional work, get together with Michael, because he's very interested in dealing with his emotional work too. And as you can see at the moment, right? Get together with him and work through stuff, right? Let yourself work through stuff.
What if you have emotions and you're dealing with somebody else has an emotions, but it's completely wrong?
Are your emotions ever completely wrong? Or when you say wrong?
Say I'm in a relationship with somebody and I have emotions for somebody else.
Oh, I see. Yes. So let's say I'm in a relationship with a partner, but I have, like, emotions towards this other girl, let's say. And what's the question you're asking?
So if you go with your emotions, then you're...
There's a total difference between going with your emotions and acting on them. Right? So I could feel a feeling of rage within me that causes me to want to kill somebody. There's a total difference between that feeling and then me going and killing them. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
Right? What I need to do is I need to focus on why I have the emotion. What's the underlying reason? To do that, feel the emotion and release it, but don't act upon it unless it's in harmony with. So it's a very basic rule. This is the only rule. Experience all of your emotions, but only act upon the ones that are in harmony with love. That's all you need to remember. Now, I include love of self in that, right? So if you feel like jumping off a cliff because of your emotions, would that be in harmony with? No. So you wouldn't do it, right? Does that make sense? So there will be times through your emotions that you'll feel like jumping off a cliff, right? I can guarantee you if you have some bad emotions within, some really sad ones, you will at times feel like jumping off a cliff, right? You can feel it, but it wouldn't be loving towards you to act upon it.
When you say act on the ones from love, it could be either divine or natural love. It's the
yes.
issue of love.
It's the issue of love, either divine or natural love, doesn't matter. And act upon the ones that are to do with truth, you know. So when you know it's the truth for certain, and obviously if it's in harmony with love, then it's going to be in harmony with truth. Act upon those.
I just want to share that my experience was similar to this gentleman's name, Nate, that was in the boxing to get in touch.
Yeah.
That it was through divine order. It wasn't through me seeking this out.
Yeah.
But I found that for myself, talk therapy didn't unlock the stuff that I had deeply buried. And it took body-centered counseling to get cracked open. And now, I'm like, my God, probably. just to encourage people for that
yes.
that might be what it takes to at least uncork the bottle, if not
yes.
continue on.
Talking about things is very ineffectual because it involves your mind a lot, and you'll try to get away from things just as much as you try to get into them. Writing about things can be sometimes more effective because you are dealing with it with yourself. But even better is always connecting with the emotion. That's the work you will need to do. Many of you do have feelings of rage or anger within you. You're going to need to connect with that. Many of you have feelings of sadness within you. You're going to need to connect with that. Does that make sense? If you want to be on this divine path, you're going to need to connect with that.
So if you go in conflict with your emotions, something that's off the divine path, then there's repercussions that come back to you.
Yep. If you go along with your emotions and act that's in disharmony with love, you will have painful repercussions, either now or later in your soul condition.
Doing yoga or doing ropes course activities where it's not involving words and there's an opportunity to experience emotions, we can work through our emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Through either of them, it's like the body doesn't lie. If I'm
mm-hmm.
scared
yep.
up on a platform,
yep.
you know, then I get to feel and read through and work through them.
That's right.
Okay, same with yoga.
It depends on your intent. See, a lot of people go to do yoga to tune out of their emotions. Some go to tune in.
Okay.
What's your intent? If you go and do any type of work, therapy-wise or talk-wise or anything, even talking, if your intent is to run away or to get commiseration from somebody else rather than to feel what you're feeling, then your intent is to get away from your emotions. So look at your intentions. So sure, there are so many different forms of therapy that are very helpful, right? Mind-body therapy, craniosacral therapy, there's all sorts of therapies. Very, very good for you to connect with your emotions. But in the end, if your intent is to deny, I've seen some people go to therapists for 10 years trying to deal with a child abuse issue. And after 10 years, they are still in exactly the same place emotionally that they were 10 years ago. Because their intent was to get away. Anyway, that's all I'll be able to do today. Thank you for your time.